Sounds like God got out of the wrong side of bed this morning.
I hate his auditions. I don't mind being treated like puppets, but worms?
Or merchandise?
Personally, I wouldn't mind him being such a shit if he wasn't so goddamn talented.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
That singular sensation, Katrina Porter.
Oh, hi, Anna Serene.
Welcome to Split Happens, everyone else.
Welcome, everybody.
Each week, Katrina and I discuss a movie both of us love. However, only one of us can say anything good about the movie, and they are the pro of the episode, which means the other is the con and has to attack it. Our one rule is the con only has to attack during the synopsis, and if they say anything good at all about the movie during that time, they incur a penalty and will have to give some love to a movie they hate, which the pro is to decide. So this week, if I catch a rule break from Katrina, you're going to hear the sound.
I'm in a glass case of emotion.
This feels right. This feels right.
Being back in the studio?
Being the pro.
What do you even talk? You were the pro last time.
I know.
And you got 2 button pushes, dirty whore.
Oh, I do recall. What are you going to do to this one?
I am going to step ball change my way through this movie like a gaggle of boundaryless dancers who will literally tell you anything you ask them. Any ideas what we're doing?
Step ball change, boundaryless.
Gaggle of them.
Okay, I almost said diapers for some reason. I don't know why. I don't know where that came from.
Because they're babies.
Well, they don't have boundaries.
Yeah.
They can step ball change.
Some of them.
And they'll tell you anything.
Mm-hmm.
Well, God, I can't think of another movie it could be, except for 1985's A Chorus Line.
5, 6, 7, 8.
Let me dance for you. Let me try. I am happy and devastated. I am thrilled and pickled.
Pickled? Oh, I love that.
I am cheerful and
despondent.
Sad.
Oh, sad.
I love this movie so much. And there are legitimately bad things about it,
mm-hmm.
which as I was watching it and trying to look at it from that lens, I was irritated that there were negative things about it. Like, I like coming up with stupid shit.
Yeah. It's always tough when we find something that's actually like, ooh, that's a problem.
At one point, Ty goes, well, isn't your attack just that this isn't a good movie? So he doesn't live here anymore, but we had a good run.
Yeah. You step ball changed him right out of this house.
right, I did.
No.
He still lives here. But, and yes, was it an accurate point? Okay. None of the things that I noticed and will say in a few minutes mm-hmm. with meaning do I actually mean.
I think we can say this is kind of an unusual one because you were going to be the pro.
Yeah.
On this. So I hadn't started any attacks yet, but I went in knowing like, well, this won't be hard. There's plenty to attack. So yeah, when we changed it up, yeah, it really is. It's very easy for us to take either side.
Remember the last couple episodes when we've talked about your girl crying in the shower? Well, she's still there. And it's just, you're
selling a house.
I'm selling a house. Although, what's so funny is Anna and I were having water before this. That was silly. And the pictures were taken to put the house on the market. And I was like, really, the picture I'm most excited about is I really can't wait to see how the studio was photographed. That's really going to be a selling point.
Hey, if there's any jingle jangles, I feel like I should say this. Your dog, Reese.
Hey, everybody. He's still alive. Reese is still kicking.
He sure is.
Isn't he a sweet boy?
Wow. I can tell you that as far as this movie goes, the audience and maybe some of the critics agree with Ty.
What?
Yeah.
They didn't like it?
They did not. They did not. It cost $25 million to make. I know.
Hold on a second. This movie, and it's going to my notes. This movie cost $25 million.
question mark. Where did it go? I can tell you, probably in the director's cut. In the director's pocket.
I was going to say, there's a director's cut and I'm just now finding out about it?
Well, I just worded it weird.
Huh, where's that gem?
It grossed about $14.2 million by the end of its run. Yeah.
What?
It was hugely successful as a play. It was very, very successful.
But it had a big cult following.
Kind of.
With us? Is no one going to listen to this episode?
Oh, you mean the movie?
Oh, yeah.
I think so. I hope so. The movie's great-ish. We love it.
I
will absolutely. You can still say it. We're not in the synopsis.
Paying attention to the shitty things about it made me love it zero less.
I'm not fucking with you. I watched it 4 times. I watched it fucking 4 times.
I know. In my notes, I have almost as many things that I shouldn't say.
I think I might get another button push off of you.
About Richie?
Possibly.
I'm worried it's going to be about Richie.
I will tell you that this movie, most of the trivia available is in relation to the play
version of it. So not a lot about the movie.
Correct. So it'll be mostly chitty-chatting about the actual movie itself, and then give you little bits of trivia. I don't want to get into the meat of the play. Because, I mean, it's interesting and all that, but that's not what this is. This is about the movie.
The only time I've seen this play was when Theodore Lawrence did it.
It was directed, you already know this, but it was directed by Richard Attenborough.
Which kills me.
Yeah.
And also explains a lot.
It does, kind of. I mean, there were a lot of eyebrows raised at the time because it didn't make sense to anyone, literally anyone. Not theater people. Not the movie. Like, why is this British? And I think that was kind of a criticism, is why is this, quintessential British actor / director going to do a movie about American theater?
Mm-hmm.
And how is he going to be able to capture it? Because, the American part of it, especially New York, is such a big part of it.
Right.
So, but he had just done Gandhi. So he could kind of do whatever he wanted. And he wanted to do it. He felt like he didn't know much about musical theater and, of course, the New York theater scene or whatever. But he said, I know people. And that is what this movie is about. It's just the different characters telling stories. This movie has, as you know, a pretty substantial main cast. So no disrespect to any of those particular actors. I will go ahead and list who those are in the description of the episode, but we're going to just go off of character names for the most part, for most of them.
Okay.
Oh, I will go ahead and say as one more, little small disclaimer about this movie. I understand that many of our listeners go back and watch these movies if they haven't seen them prior to us doing the episode. You might not love it. But we really do, and a lot of people really do. I just find it so incredibly delightful. If you could just put a few things aside and just go in going, I'm going to have a good time. You're going to have a blast.
You know, you've been with us through Care Bears. You've been with us through He-Man.
Yeah.
Take this ride with us
Grease
as well.
Grease 2.
Yeah, it's safe.
This isn't our first musical rodeo.
No.
Mm-hmm. Katrina?
What?
Do you have anything to say before we get in?
I love this movie. Play that fucking song.
Let the games begin.
Our movie begins, and if you say this movie promised sexual content and didn't deliver, I'm going to hoist the big old bullshit flag.
Nope.
Well, our movie begins.
Nope.
It does, though.
The movie starts with a lot of traffic and people standing way too close to each other. And this movie is terrible.
Oh, shit. Well, I'm going to say that it also has singing and dancing and somebody shouting stage directions. That sounds awesome.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Why isn't Tim Curry red? And if red wasn't available, no butler suit?
Why wasn't he red?
Yeah.
What do you mean red?
Like when he was in Legend.
Oh. I'm such a fucking idiot. I thought you meant like R-E-A-D. And I'm like, is that a theater term? What do you mean?
No, it's a nonsense term.
Okay. I feel like I can clear a few things up.
Okay.
There are a shitload of people lined up to audition outside of a theater. And Larry, a.k.a. Terrence Mann, a.k.a. not Tim Curry.
Says you.
Him, it's fact. He is leading them through steps. And oh, Susie, are there ever a lot of steps?
Strong arms again. Step, push, shot, pivot, touch, kick. That connects with turn, turn, right, left, hop, step, pivot, step, touch, kick, and down. You got it?
I also don't like bridges.
You're still going back to the traffic? You said you had garbage. I just didn't know it was, you know, garbage.
It gets better. Or worse, depending on your perspective.
I can say it because I can say a few criticism type things, especially self-deprecating. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure I would have fucked up on pivot. And that is the first step. I'm just fascinated by because people, they, when he was saying those things, they just did it.
Later on, when he's like, has the hat and you move your hand here and then you go back, I was like, absolutely not.
No, I'm out. I'm so sorry.
Why don't they call them men and women instead of boys and girls?
That's how it is in the theater.
I don't think so.
I think it is. Mm. This was 85. It was all boys and girls.
Mm.
It was before that, it was chicks and dudes. And before that, it was guys and dolls, which is why there's the musical about it.
That's not true.
Yeah, anyway, at 5, 6, 7, 8, not Tim Curry, is weeding out dancers left and right. And he must be extremely good at his job because most of them seem really great to me.
Except the lady in the gray with the purple belt who is married to the guy with an equally thick New York accent is pretty terrible and it makes no sense that she didn't get cut right away.
They see something in her.
And the husband isn't even that great, so it can't be. He is so amazing, we don't want to lose him, so let's string the bimbo along.
Well, you find out later he's worked for Zach a number of times. He's experienced. He's a bit of a veteran. Can I tell you a little bit of trivia that's actually interesting?
Yes, because I can like that.
You sure can. Madonna auditioned for this under her full name and was rejected by director Richard Attenborough himself.
This was in when?
85.
Which was way before League of Their Own when we learned that she wasn't very nice.
Yeah, this was Lucky Star Madonna. Like, this is right before she, like, killed it on... But she auditioned under her, like, when she was a dancer.
Oh.
Like, 3,000 people auditioned for this. A lot of dancers.
Wow.
Because it was huge on Broadway. A Chorus Line, that was the problem to get into... Not to get into too much of the musical, but it was incredibly popular. Because it was all about the dancers. They actually went and interviewed a bunch of dancers and asked them about their life stories and things like that. And recorded them for, like, 16 hours. And then they took those stories and turned them into characters. A lot of them played themselves. I think it's like when Hollywood has like movies come out about Hollywood. They kind of really fucking love that. Oh. And they celebrate that a lot. This is kind of how it was. It was like Chorus Line was celebrating Broadway. You know, gotcha. It was a little inbred. But so it was hugely popular, but nobody could get it on screen for like 10 years. They couldn't get it on screen because they're like, this is not an adaptable play.
Hmm.
This is not going to work on the big screen. So anyway, a lot of people auditioned for it because it was well known at that point.
Ah, too bad there weren't more people that auditioned with talent.
A lot of people auditioned. You see all those people that 5, 6, 7, 8 got cut?
Yeah, not Sheila.
He's picky. He's real picky.
Not picky enough.
Not Tim Curry? Yeah. A lone man, a stage show director, Zach, played by Michael Douglas, sits in a darkened auditorium and occasionally yelling out directions. Oh, no. Well, according to my notes, auditioners is not actually a word. At least not how I spelled it. But they're going through the whole routine for him. And one of the dancers, clearly a veteran and a queen amongst mortals, is Sheila. And she decides to just take a break from the dancing. Because I mean, veteran isn't like longtime dancer, not like, you know, thank you for your service.
Speaking of that, real quick, our brother Jason retires from the Air Force tomorrow.
Yeah, we wanted so badly to be with him in Hawaii to celebrate this incredible milestone. It just happens to coincide with incredibly busy work things and all and
crazy selling time a for house. Life. But anyway, Jason, we love you and I'm proud of you.
Love you, love you, love you, yeah.
But this bitch Sheila is not a veteran like you are.
No, she's a veteran of dance.
She sucks.
What?
She's lazy.
You're a liar.
She doesn't actually seem that great. Why isn't she cut right away?
You know why? You know who likes her?
Who?
Zach. He is amused by Sheila's gumption. And I get it. Because I personally would very much like to be Sheila when I grow up. I worship her as she should be.
I'm not saying something positive. The guy who would be my pony on any reality show.
Richie.
Is going twice as fast as everyone else, and those are not the steps.
He's very excited. He just knows them really, really well, and they can see that. They know it.
What song are they singing right now?
Well, this dance has a lot of spins and claps, and I find it exhilarating. And God, I hope some of them get it. I hope they get it. But how many people does he need? How many boys?
How many girls? Okay, but they're all singing that, and this bitch in the back is like going off script like, I really need this job. Those aren't the words.
But she does. She really needs it.
There are more balls flying around in this movie than a ball pit.
Oh, man. Those pants are something.
Tim Curry has the same look on his face that I do. Like, what the fuck is Sheila doing here?
Who?
Tim Curry.
I don't remember him in this movie.
He's great.
Oh! I'm in a glass case of emotion!
Yes, 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 yes! Oh, my God! I thought for sure it was going to be Richie.
Wait. You said Tim Curry isn't in this movie. So if I said Tim Curry is great, then that means it can't be real.
It can't be real. You're fucked. Oh, I can't believe it. I don't know what to do with my hands.
Oh, no. Tim Curry betrayed me.
Hey, Katrina Porter.
What?
I want you to say something nice about the movie, the 80s movie, Children of the Corn.
No.
We liked it at the time.
I loved it when I was young.
Yeah, but what about now?
I went back and watched it.
Oh, no!
As an adult.
What's something good about it?
You know, farmers are the backbone of this country. And there was a lot of corn in that movie.
Damn, you're spit on my wine. You know what? I'll accept it because I agree.
Thank you. Thank you, farmers.
Thank you. One girl, the girl in the yellow trunks, is not doing so great. And Zach yells at her to stop dancing.
This is the first time of many where we see him as a real dickhead.
He just, you know, he knows what he wants. When you're in the biz for that long, you got to be tough as nails. Nails tough.
Okay, I'll talk about that later.
Steel nails. Made in Detroit. What do you not like about Detroit?
I love Detroit.
Do you?
Yeah.
Well, they have the Red Wings, so fuck them. Anyway, we see Sheila.
In case anyone's wondering, if we're getting close to playoff season for the NHL.
Yeah, that's an old rivalry. And I hate other teams more, but still, fuck them. Sheila, the goddess, has a GBF. Is that an appropriate term still?
Gay best friend?
Yeah.
I hope so.
God, I hope so, because I use it all the time.
God, it's a term of endearment.
Apologies if that's not acceptable. I love every conversation she has with her GBF Bobby. Whilst auditions are ongoing, a redheaded lady has been traveling via taxi.
Over a bridge.
Over a bridge.
Big one.
She's there late, and judging by the bags that she has with her, looks like she's brought her everything she owns. This is Cassie, and we'll come back to her a little bit later.
No, we'll talk about her now.
Oh, okay.
She starts talking with Zach's secretary, and I am personally insulted, and I'm not even in this movie. She says, "Didn't you used to be a dancer?" And then she follows that up with, "I saw you when I was in high school."
Oof. I don't like that.
Yeah.
I missed all of that.
I didn't.
I don't know what I was doing.
Cut. Step ball change.
Not Tim Curry bumps Sheila to the back, and this bitch, I am obsessed with her. Obsessed. Not like I want to wear her like a skin suit kind of way, but if I could just like be like inside her. Like, not weird. Your face is, I'm talking weird. I'm not talking weird. I mean, shrunk down like an inner space type of thing, you know, like shrunk down and then in a pod and then injected inside of her.
Yeah. Fuck. So fucking weird.
Yeah. I just want to be inside her.
So real fucking weird.
All I'm saying is.
Okay. Cool.
Not in a weird way.
She's like Ron Burgundy. I want to be in you. I want to be on you.
I want to be on you. Such a nice hiney. Cassie shows up and she wants to see Zach because they used to bump. And he totally dismisses her, and I don't think he's happy to see her. But he is trying to do a show, and she's kind of like inserting herself. I love that some of the guys are really fucking good at the jumps, especially Richie, who accidentally leaps into the arms of not Tim Curry.
Remember when we saw Frozen on Ice? And there was that one fabulous skater who was skating circles around everyone.
Yes!
A sea of glitter in his tracks.
Oh, I'm so glad you made me remember that because,
okay. That is Richie, who I definitely do not have anything good to say about. So don't even try because I have it all through my notes. But I definitely don't like him. He is not funny or charming. So don't try.
Oh, no. You're going to get another button.
I'm not because I don't like him. I don't think he's good.
Richie? You want to do that one again?
No, thank you.
One of the criticisms about changes made for the movie is that they focus more on the relationship between Cassie and Zach. And if I remember correctly, it's possible I don't, and I refuse to fact check it, but I think the actress that plays Cassie, oh no, I know she was. She was also in the stage production. Actually, several of them were, so I'll just get back to that.
But when Cassie says she's there to audition, Zach is like, it's nothing but chorus. Like, yeah. Way to boost the morale of the rest of the losers who are there for just chorus.
We're standing right here.
I don't find Sheila charming at all. And she's obnoxious. And this bitch ain't 30.
You lying. 5, 6, 7, 8. Time for more eliminations. And this brings us to the main group we see for the rest of the movie. One of the dancers... is Paul. And poor sweet Paul might have a problem with anxiety. And I kind of just want to give him a hug. And then a different shirt. It was the 80s. Maggie introduces herself. She's the one that was saying how much she needs this job.
Right.
Can I tell you something about her? About sure. The actress?
Yeah.
I didn't write her name down, but I will in the notes.
Margaret?
Who is her real name? But this is another term. A time whenever I saw that Peggy is a nickname for Margaret. I just can't get my mind around that. It's not related to the movie. Maggie introduces herself. This actress ended up marrying the guy standing next to her, the one that plays the I Can Do That Mike in real life.
You can say something. Okay. Yeah. Oh,
yeah.
I love married. That.
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
yeah.
We saw him in he was in Grease too.
He sure was.
That's right.
Reproduction. Reproduction.
Connie Wong gives her name as she makes an Asian joke about herself. About herself. Because it was the 80s. That was still okay.
Mm-hmm.
Now on to Sheila, who is flanked by two newly befriended top echelon gay men. And the first is Gregg. Is very comfortable with himself. And Zach likes him immediately, duh. And Sheila introduces herself and she says she's about to turn 30.
Liar.
Well, she's technically 36 in real life.
Mm.
You don't think that you could play 30?
Me?
Yeah.
No.
I bet you could with the right makeup and,
no.
and filter.
No. First of all, did you see me trying to sit in this chair?
Yeah, but once you're in the chair, you look young as fuck.
I don't think so.
It's your skincare routine.
That makes me think of David Rose. It's just this 9-step regimen that I do twice a day. It's nothing.
I like to think that Sheila has transcended something as trivial as age. Bobby is Sheila's other new bestie, and he is 100% the person we would have gravitated towards. We would have just sat in the audience, in the auditorium, and just made bitchy comments through the rest of the time.
I have no comment.
I love that journey for us. And I think that it's not too late. Next up is BB. She's a little shy, but she's an amazing fucking dancer, and she is gorgeous. After her is Judy Monroe, and I'll go ahead and say she is played by Janet Jones. I'm calling her out specifically because she has been married to Wayne Gretzky since 1988. Judy cracks a lot of jokes. She's the one that's like,
El Paso, Texas.
Yeah, she actually, I really should have written this down. I really should have. But Janet Jones was caught up in a gambling scandal, and I'm not quite sure that it's actually all the way done. Because she was doing some gambling that she probably shouldn't have been doing with like a half a dozen other NHL players.
Mm.
After her is my absolute favorite. He says,
"Hi, my name is Richie Walters. 21 years old. I was born on a full moon in Herculaneum, Missouri. And I'm black."
Next to him is Alan DeLuca, and he's 28 years old, and he's from the Bronx. And he has got a strong brow, doesn't he? His brow is doing heavy work, keeping the rest of his forehead up.
That brow is the only thing working.
That's a Bronx brow. Trademark. Next to him is his very young wife, Elaine, with a voice that is totally fine.
"I'm Christine Ehrlich. I'm 18 years old. I'm from St. Louis, Missouri."
Everything is with a question mark at the end because she's constantly confused. "I'm in the theater right now?"
She seemed very confused. Do you know who she is?
No.
Okay. She's actually played by somebody pretty significant. It's the only other person I think I'm going to name, like their actual name. It's Nicole Fossey, Bob Fossey's daughter.
Oh.
Right. Cool. Which is amazing because when you were talking earlier about the one in the gray being such a shitty dancer, she really, I mean this sincerely, like I went back and watched in the 18 times I rewatched this, watched her, and she's very good at making it look like she does not dance well, which is amazing that she manages to get through this next round. There's just something about her.
It's shocking.
That they love.
Some would say shocking that she made it through.
That's Zach. He sees far away stars, even if they're not super bright and all that. He sees them.
Mm-hmm.
Val introduces herself, and she's the one with the boobies the girls keep staring at.
Mm-hmm.
And that actress was on the popular show Dallas at the time. She's not technically a dancer. She's a singer and an actress. She did a lot of the dancing, but like the like big shots and stuff like that, they had to do a double. Adorable little dummy Mark introduces himself and wants Zach to know if he gets the part, he's going to work real hard. And the rest of the dancers are a collective Jesus Christ with this kid.
This is not a pro.
Okay.
Oh. All I'm saying is if I was in this lineup.
Yeah. It's not a fun. Okay, criminal justice major. This is not a lineup.
What is it called?
I don't know. Dance line?
Dance line. If I was in this dance line, how fast do you think I would be taking care of Mark?
Do you mean Paul?
Well, and Paul, but Mark, right? You just mentioned Mark. You were like, I'm going to try real hard.
You would have.
I'd be elbowing people out of the way.
You would have made sure he's safe. Speaking of which, up next, the ball of anxiety, Paul.
Mm-hmm.
And he really needs a good therapist like Katrina. Aw. And somebody, like, to take care of him and give him a hug and tell him it's okay and none of that trauma that he has is his fault. And you know what? I say you gotta admire someone who shows up to a dancing audition in jeans.
He's wearing jeans. And loafers. He's wearing jeans and loafers. God. And a belt.
Bold. So brave. After that is Morales. Deanna Morales.
Uh-huh.
She is sassy and I love her.
Well, she also doesn't know directions for shit.
What?
She says the Bronx is uptown and to the right and she points to the left.
Yeah, she meant stage left. Stage no. right.
Mm-mm.
Yeah, it's the opposite.
This movie's terrible. On stage.
After introductions, Zach lets the group know this will be an audition like no other. And I don't know why he needs Dancer to dredge up their childhood trauma, but he's the visionary, you know?
Question.
Yeah.
As Zach mentioned earlier,
This
is just chorus. So why is it so important for him to get to know them and shake them up?
Because he understands that every cog in the machine needs to be unique and beautiful. And lots of trauma.
This sounds like some pervy shit.
What? No, not pervy. He wants them to know that he cares more about them than just 5, 6, 7, 8, you know?
Mm-mm. I think the dum-dum from St. Louis who was like, honey, can we please go? Probably had the smartest moment of her life. But of course her husband was like, quiet, sugar tits. You're here to be seen and not heard. Shake a tail feather.
Well, then he's trying to progress her out of her comfort zone. And sounds like that was a good plan. Because he's been through this a lot. And he knows that she can do it.
Did every smartass in Brooklyn audition for this show?
Pretty much, yeah. I already said like 3,000 people. That's like the entirety of Brooklyn, right? No. There's more than 3,000 people in Brooklyn. What about 1985?
Yes.
Prove it. Mike shares his story via song. And it's one that you and I quote all the time.
Said, I can do that. I can do that.
Question.
Yeah.
Is it an option to just speak your biography, or is it a requirement that it be in song form accompanied by a cheeky dance number?
Question.
What?
Is this a musical?
Is it?
Yes. It is classified as a musical, yes.
Well, then you answered your question.
Well, I answered yours as well at the same time. Look, I can do that. Look at my feet. I can do that. That I can do.
No, that's not.
His dance is very spin heavy. And there's a part where Mike pulls Richie from the lineup.
Does Mike
really? Oh, shit. I said lineup too. Oh, no. Dance line.
Does Mike really want to dance next to Richie?
Funny you should say that. Because he gets
to dance with him.
Funny I should say that. I guess that wasn't originally in the script. And Mark, you already talked about needing to take care of, because you understand how well this actor is playing this character. This is Mark, not Mike. Mike is I can do that. Mark suggested the idea that he might have been a little like, he suggested the idea that they pull another, that he pull another dancer to dance with him. And he may have been a little bit salty that they used his idea, but not him.
Oh, that's not nice. That's a con.
It's a scandalo.
Question.
Yeah.
Where did Mike get a rope swing?
They come with that. Didn't you see the gigantic bags that they've taken with them? All of them. God. You know what? You're not involved in the dance scene in Broadway and on stage, but you have to bring in comfortable movement clothes. And
Paul didn't get the memo on that.
He's comfortable with himself and in that.
He's comfortable with nothing.
Actually, he's not comfortable with anything. So it perfectly makes sense that he would come in jeans. Ooh, God. That he would show up in jeans. But they also have to bring a rope swing and then probably also some other props if it comes up later.
Accoutrement.
Bobby is up next. What do you want to say? I feel like you want to say something about Bobby.
I don't believe a word of what Bobby Mills III is saying.
Neither does Zach.
He would break into people's houses to rearrange their furniture. Don't threaten me with a good time.
Awesome. Again, I say, no wonder Sheila loves him. He's the one that I said that you and I would, he's the one that I said you and I would gravitate towards. Don't threaten me with a good time. Again, I knew you were going to like him.
I didn't say I like him. This is a true story.
True story.
halfway through the process of getting this house ready to sell, I started leaving my front door unlocked, hoping to get robbed so people would just take shit from the house.
That's the fucking saddest thing I've ever heard.
Please, just come take our shit so I don't have to move it anywhere.
Just rid me of all of this. This stuff. Please. Not the books. What are you doing? Not the books. What if they came in and rearranged your books?
I locked this door.
By color.
Anna, I was looking up how people arrange their libraries, people and that is that. An option.
That is an option.
I don't agree.
No?
No.
Your face is flushed right now.
Because do you know that means that they're not even arranged by author?
No, definitely not.
You don't have to be arranged color. By genre. That's okay. But you're not going to have them grouped? We're in alphabetical order? I don't believe you, Bobby. That's all I'm saying.
And then there's the goddess on Earth, Sheila. Oh, she's so fucking cool.
I have a question. What does the line, "Life with my dad was never a picnic, more like a come as you are," mean? What does that mean?
Well, a picnic sounds organized. And come as you are sounds like maybe he didn't have a whole lot of plan. He was kind of a loosey-goosey kind of father. You know, like in and out of your life. Come as you are.
Wow, that explanation actually makes sense.
Oh, thank God. Didn't me.
Gobsmacked.
Well, obviously she gets song. And she's such a wonderful fucking human that she even shares her song with two other gals.
No. No.
Yes, she does.
No, she doesn't.
I saw it.
She shares her song with Beatrice. And they were having a fine time singing a duet. And then Beatrice? Maggie creeps in the back.
Who's Beatrice?
The green.
Oh, I love her. BB? Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
And then Maggie shows up?
Yeah, Maggie's just like creepy in the back. And like, I bet she never went to the ballet.
I bet she did. And you know what? Maybe Maggie showed up because she's clearly the strongest singer out of all of them. She's like, you know what? I can give you some help.
Maggie just did not have a song. She's like, everything is beautiful at the Chuck E. Cheese. Doesn't have quite the same ring as ballet.
At the ballet. Right. At the Chuck E. Cheese. At the ski ball.
There's a ball pit. What was the band one with the mouse and
the Chuck E. Cheese? Oh, although it was also there was showbiz and Chuck E. Cheese.
I was thinking showbiz.
And there was like, it was like, you know, Bloods and Crips. Although I think they were actually like associated and not like rival gangs that murdered people.
I think we were on the showbiz, right? We were on their side?
Well, we started with Chuck E. Cheese and then it evolved to showbiz and we were like totally fine with that.
Well, then there's Peter Piper's Pizza.
That's
okay. Moving on.
That's a whole nother universe.
Okay.
Yeah, up next, Christine and Alan DeLuca talk a little bit. You sweet dumb Muppets.
I ain't too bright and I ain't too talented.
That's true. I don't know. I mean, they got this far. Hey, Mark and a few of the others want to chit-chat about sex. Next.
After I had my first wet dream, I went straight to the medical book and looked it up. Milky discharge. Oh my God, gonorrhea.
And I am so fucking uncomfortable. Until, of course.
No.
What?
Zach asks a lot of intrusive questions. It's fucking chorus, Zach.
Yeah, he told him from the start. He had a lot of questions. He needed to know about their childhood, about their likes, their dislikes, their blood type, if they're Star Trek or Star Wars.
No, I'm fine with the word milk. And I'm fine with the word discharge. Milky discharge, absolutely not. No. And Mark going to his priest to discuss milky discharge was probably the worst mistake of his life besides those yellow sweatpants.
I mean, I don't love the term milky discharge either. And I want to stop talking about it.
Well, I want you to keep saying it because I don't want you to talk about Richie.
You got it. I will be saying it for the next 5 episodes. Milky discharge. Oh, your face. That worked well. Anyway, let's talk about Richie.
No.
The other people are doing just fine talking about their sexual history. And then Richie runs into the room, metaphorically speaking, and says,
talk about love, man. My first time was with this girl, Paulette. Forget about it. We did it in a graveyard.
We did it in a graveyard. And then we did it again.
Richie says the words sweet, icicle hot, sweet as a lemon pie, sailing across the ocean. But then he says, we liked it a lot. Like he ran out of adjectives.
Fucking art. Art.
We liked it okay.
He is the wordsmith of our generation. And then we did it again.
How does everyone know this choreography that Richie's making up on the fly? The characters.
Yeah.
Are supposedly like making their dances up.
They're dancers. They are trained dancers. They've been around the block once or twice, according to Alan DeLuca. He's been around quite. Sheila has been around long enough.
His song's like 5 minutes long.
It is. So instead of talking about it, I guess now is as good of a time, good of a time as any, to do an in memoriam, because a few cast members are no longer with us. They died pretty young.
Richie did.
Richie. Alan DeLuca. Yeah, he died of HIV.
Alan did?
Mm-hmm. Mike. I can do that.
What?
AIDS? I think he died during surgery, maybe? Or that might have been Richie. They all died fairly young. So I just want to say I thought they were wonderful in this movie. They need to have a cigarette break, like a 5 minute break or whatever, mm-hmm. probably because they just found out who all is dead. And they need a break. I get it. I'm like that every Oscars.
Oh my God.
Sheila says she needs a cigarette break and maybe a pee because her kidneys need it or whatever. But actually she just goes and smokes down with Cassie, I think.
Yes, that's correct.
And then not Tim Curry finds her and he's like,
Sheila, get your ass up on stage.
Sheila, get your ass back on stage.
Meanwhile, back at the ranch. By ranch, I mean backstage. Cassie is reminiscing about the good old times with Zach because they have history.
Oh my God.
And on stage, Morales is singing about her acting teacher.
Halfway through Morales' song about not being able to be ice cream, I wanted Zach to be like, boo.
I get it. That sounds fucking insufferable.
Also, get off the stage, Todd. Go back to the restaurant.
Oh, he is the worst, that jackass waiter. Dancer. How did he even get to this round? And he has also, I don't appreciate his pants. First of all, I don't like the color. Also, you can see he's pretty meaty down there. And I feel like he probably should have done something that makes him not so meaty down there.
This movie should be called Group Therapy and Leg Warmers, led by Gary Busey, set to music.
Ooh, God, can you imagine? Can you imagine?
Yeah, that's this movie.
But there's no coke.
There's lots of coke. Lots of coke going on in this movie.
I swear to God, I cannot think of Gary Busey without thinking about the fact that when he snorted his spilled coke off of his dog's fur, that's when he knew that he had to hit his rock bottom. 5, 6, 7, 8. It's time for some tits and ass. I am absolutely fucking dying at how much Zach is enjoying Val's performance. That is the most realistic part of this movie, and you know it.
He's real interested in Val's journey.
He definitely is.
Left the theater and called the doctor for my appointment to buy tits and ass. Bought myself a fancy pair.
Okay, so I already have told you this, but I have to talk about the fact that my coworker, when he was in high school in Buffalo, I think, Buffalo, New York, his school did this musical.
Are you talking about Eric?
Yeah.
Okay.
They did this musical. But again, I want to mention, in high school, they did a chorus line. So you want to know what they changed this song to?
Yeah.
Instead of tits and ass, it was this and that.
Oh, God.
That's incredible.
That's crazy.
The brass balls on that drama teacher. Poor nervous, anxious Paul has to follow Val. And that's unfortunate.
Paul is like me if I got pulled on stage and was asked questions. Katrina, I mean Paul, you are here at an audition for chorus. Do you like singing and dancing? Why do we have to talk about it?
I don't know, we have to talk about it. Wow, it is you.
Right?
You wouldn't wear jeans, though, to that. You'd wear movement clothes.
Dude, I wear leggings now.
Do you own jeans?
A pair. They're a lot of work to get into.
There's so much work.
My calves aren't made for jeans.
You know what they are made for?
Walking.
Movement clothes.
Yeah. You guys, my dog is snoring so loud. I'm sorry.
He's so cute. You know that Cassie, she just won't take no for an answer. And she goes on stage to convince Zach. So he dismisses everyone so that she can have a song and dance number. But she's just too damn good for chorus, he says. Her dancing trudges up some memories and he definitely does not want that. And he tells her to fuck off, kind of.
She's not coming across as a super sympathetic character. She's just kind of like busts on stage. And then she says she hasn't worked in a year. But supposedly she's like this super great, amazing dancer. Why the fuck haven't you worked in a year?
It's tough out there for a pimp.
Really? You haven't done shit?
I didn't do fucking shit. I didn't do this. I mean, it's tough. She moved to Vegas or California.
She moved to California.
California.
If only there was a job in California. She makes me want to be a Zach apologist, and that is a con.
It was the 80s. It was tough out there for a dancer. This particular actress has played a number of characters, actually. She's done a chorus line several times. She's obviously an actual dancer. She played Cassie on stage for a chorus line, and then she also did Sheila. And actually, the actress that played Sheila has also played Cassie. Many of them have played, have done a chorus line either through stage or through Broadway specifically. Many of them. None of them, I don't think, were original cast members, though. But a lot of them have. So she is very familiar with this particular character.
Well, just an observation.
Yes?
The people who are good dancers cannot act.
What?
And the people who are good actors cannot sing.
You know, it's tough to find unicorns. We saw that movie. Oh, we saw Legend with the actual Tim Curry.
Why are you disrespecting him? It's not...
Not at all.
It's not his fault. He can literally do everything.
He's not in this.
He is.
He is not in this.
He's so good.
We need to put like a side-by-side of Terrence Mann and Tim Curry so you can see that they are two different persons.
Doppelgangers.
Now that might be the case. I'm just saying. That didn't make him the same person.
You know, if Zach is so goddamn talented, why does he quit asking questions about their mommy issues and give poor Tim Curry a break teaching these chuglets some moves?
I watched an interview with him and, I can't remember her name, the actress that plays Cassie. I just can't think of it. I'm so sorry. I watched an interview with them and he auditioned for this because I think he was with Cats at the time. He was Mr. Mistopheles. So he does do dance, kind of, and obviously singing and, you know, acting. But he tried for this, but when they found out that his part was going to be a lot of dancing, he was like, this is not for me. I'm actually not that kind of performer. So they're like, okay, well, thank you for your time. So he went away and they kept asking him back. So he's like, well, how about I just read for a character? And I think he read for Zach and maybe Larry as well, but they were like, you're perfect for this. So he does have a little bit of dancing closer to the end, but it's just not his thing. They actually made Michael Douglas dance a little bit. He specifically didn't want to do that because he had danced a little bit, at least in like the last three movies. And he had called Kathleen Turner and was like, she's like, you're not going to make you dance, are they? Because you're shit at dancing. He's like, I don't think so. So he had to call her back like, they're actually going to make me dancing. So there's a cut scene where it shows him and Larry, not Tim Curry, on stage. I don't know if they're showing how the dance goes, but he does actually dance, but shockingly they cut it.
The disrespect you showed to Tim Curry.
5, 6, 7, 8. Poor, sweet, anxious Paul wants to talk with Zach. And again, I just want to hold him. It's even though it's a super, mega, super downer, it's a scene that actually shows some humanity in Zach. And I thought that was nice.
I want to.
Yeah.
This whole scene with Paul being forced into drag is not an accurate representation of the drag world.
But he might not be comfortable there. They might. You know how much I love drag.
This is kind of crazy. And then he calls them freaks.
He said that that's what other people thought.
No, he called them freaks.
He was saying it in their Mm-mm. view.
Nope.
It was the 80s. It was the 80s.
Paul just spills his guts. And Zach is like, whoa, whoa, whoa. I just wanted to find out how old you were when you got your cherry popped. Like, was it in a graveyard? Was it in a graveyard like Richie?
I don't want to talk about it. 5, 6, 7, 8. Everyone back on stage. And they practice the routine with hats. Even though everyone is obviously fucking up, Zach hones in on Cassie. Every one of her minor mess-ups. And he is really not nice to her, even though she's clearly the best one up there. And her legs. Oh, my God. She has great legs.
Listen, I have a complaint.
Oh?
Before this.
Okay.
Here's my complaint.
Yeah. Preach.
Okay. And this is not a pro. Mm. Because I'm allowed to objectify people. I'm allowed to objectify people.
The actors, not the characters.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. There are some pretty hot women in this movie.
Yes.
Okay. And they're not wearing much in the way of clothes.
Correct.
We get Mark and yellow sweatpants.
Yeah.
That's what the straight ladies get.
Yeah. Boo. What about Richie? And then I do again.
Not what saying
that,
anything,
what but about that fucking waiter garbage person? That's like, I don't know.
No, no, no.
I'm sorry. I can't talk to you about gender inequality at this moment. It was 1985. What do you want me to say?
So what you were saying about Zach and Cassie.
Yeah.
Am I reading the situation correct that Zach let Cassie audition so he could humiliate her?
He let her audition because she just pushed him into it. And then he's going to hone it. He can't stop looking at her. And he wants her to quit. He wants to scare her off. So he's going to keep criticizing her and just hope that she just goes off and, you know, goes off stage. And when she doesn't, he's like, God damn it. Don't you understand? This is not for you.
But shouldn't she be allowed to decide for herself what she wants to do?
Yeah, but it's Zach. Also, she kind of surprised him in all of this. Like, he was okay, and he was in his zone, and he was focused on this. And then she threw a wrench in the cog. And unfortunately, it just happened to be a super talented wrench. A wrench that has great legs and is really good at dancing. And then maybe in the, you know, backstory, like, reminiscing part, she might not have the best wig. But listen, it's a good cog.
We've got a guy who thought he had gonorrhea after he jacked off, and yet Cassie is still the most humiliated person in the room.
Zach, really, he can be, you know, cutting, acerbic.
He sucks. And, like, they keep saying, like, he's allowed to be a fucking asshole because he's so talented. Mm-hmm. What has he shown at all that he's, like, talented at? Like, he hasn't given them steps. He hasn't done anything.
Have you ever heard of a difficult director? Seriously, in Hollywood? Have there ever been any directors? Paul Thomas Anderson comes to mind. Maybe who directed William Friedkin? Did The Exorcist?
On the Weekend.
Friedkin on the Weekend.
Funny old business.
He comes to mind. There are a number of super talented directors that people continue to go after. I mean, Roman Polanski, and they fucking gave him an Oscar even after they figured out all that shit about him. I'm just saying, there are difficult directors, very problematic directors, but their talent is high enough that they're like, oh, okay, well, we're going to let a lot of shit slide. Zach pulls Cassie aside because he lures her, and unfortunately, she's playing You Can't Win with him.
Oh, I do love that game.
I love that game. It's my favorite.
Oh, I played it the other day with Ty.
Yeah?
He didn't win.
He didn't?
No, he didn't. It never happens.
I keep thinking he's going to have a shot at it. No. And then I'm like, no, that's silly.
It's the whole point. It's in the title.
You can't win.
You almost said it to the Caddyshack theme song.
Like, I'm all right. You can't win. You can't win. Cassie's pretty good at it. And she's also kind of full of shit.
Is this the part where she's like, yes, I understand that you need to devote 24 hours a day to your work, but then also I want you to devote 24 hours a day to me. Figure it out.
You can't win. She does a song after that, and it's What I Did for Love. I think it actually became a little bit of a hit. I did not look that up, but I recognized it enough. That actually rubbed a lot of stage people wrong.
Because she's so pitchy?
No.
Oh.
She just, you know, she's feeling it, and it's shot live. So, they felt like, because the a lot of the people involved, the creator, original cast members, felt like this was a wrong way to go. I should say, the person that originated a chorus line wrote it, and, you know, I wish I could remember his name. I'm so sorry.
It was John.
It was Michael something, or something.
Matthew.
But I almost want to say Mike Douglas. Of course, that's not right. But
Scott.
He was the director at first. They asked him, and then he wanted to take it, I thought, in a pretty clever direction. He wanted the movie to be kind of meta. He wanted it to be like, these particular dancers are auditioning for the movie version of a chorus line. Right. I thought that was pretty clever, but they didn't want that. So he exited. And when he left, he was like, just don't make it about just Cassie and Zach. That's not what this is about. It's about everyone. That's kind of the point, is it's a chorus. Maybe Dick Attenborough, old Dickie Addy, and the producers felt something different. And they wanted to go just kind of focus on Zach and Cassie. And they actually cut a couple songs because of that. The Hello 12 or Hello 13 or whatever.
Hello Love.
Right. That was a much bigger song. They cut that to make place for What I Did for Love.
Because that led into I Did It in a Graveyard.
And I did it again. While the group is tap dancing, poor sweet Paul has an accident and hurts his leg and he has to leave.
No, no. Actually, he falls and then suddenly everyone is a medical expert.
Yeah. I'm kind of obsessed with Cassie asking if the group has any Valium and a force. Of course.
Sheila.
Queen Sheila's like, oh yeah, I got you covered.
And they're like, are you sure he should have that? She's like, I've had three since noon.
It was the 80s. I'm just going to keep saying that. 5, 6, 7, 8. Not Tim Curry tells everybody to get on the line. And this is the final elimination. And he calls several of them to step forward. And they think they've got the part. But Zach fucking Tyra Banks's them. And everyone in the front line is actually cut.
Dude, that's fucking mean.
This is an insanely crazy way to do it.
Listen. I've seen this movie, 12,000 times?
Mm-hmm.
Every time that happens, I'm like, that's the meanest fucking thing ever. I get agitated, and I know what's happening.
Yeah.
And what I do, because I torture myself,
yeah,
is I really look closely at their faces. Like,
oh, no.
How excited are each person?
Oh, no, that's the worst thing you can do.
They're so happy.
They're so happy.
And then they look so dejected. Like,
so dejected. Yeah, they're going to have to tell this story to another fucking chorus line. Yeah.
Yeah,
I understand you did it for the first time in a graveyard, but this one time I was in a fucking chorus line.
See?
And I thought we got the part and they asked us to move forward, but actually they didn't. I'm going to sing a song about it. Here it goes, 5, 6, 7, 8.
But that's the problem. The next time they go to an audition, they're going to think it's therapy time. And that director is going to just want them to do something crazy.
Mm.
Just dance and sing.
Yeah.
And they're going to want to talk about their issues.
Yeah.
And they're going to not get that part either. Because the director's going to be like, this fucker just wants to talk about their shit.
They better figure it out. Directors are different.
Zach has screwed these people up forever.
Man.
He's the worst.
It's a really, really difficult environment. Difficult industry. Dancing is a difficult industry.
No.
Yeah.
That can't be possible.
Dancing and singing.
No. Because the way they explain how they get through everything,
dancing and acting,
is by being a dancer. I am a dancer.
Ding, ding, ding.
That's who I am.
I have come home.
Let me in.
The last bit of the movie.
No.
Nope.
When the poor losers have to walk away, yes, Mark sorry. Looks like he just got gonorrhea in his pants again.
Yeah, he did.
He's like...
Oh, because he was one of the chosen one.
Right.
Oddly enough, they didn't sing a song about this. Probably because there's a bunch of people that just got the biggest disappointment of their life. But...
Like, that would have stopped him.
Also, it was correct. We couldn't have that waiter dipshit in there. We couldn't have the married couple, sweet as they were, Alan and Elaine DeLuca.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Mm-hmm. I'm not... None of those people should have been in the lineup to begin with because they all were terrible.
Says you.
I'm not arguing that they shouldn't have been cut. They shouldn't have been there. My argument at this point in the movie is that why don't you just say these are the people that... are going to have more free time. You could have framed it like that. He could have said, Tom, you know you're worried about picking up some shifts at the diner?
Yeah.
You're good. You're going to have plenty of time.
He wasn't just looking for dances. He wanted people with heart.
That's not what he's looking for.
He was. He was. He was looking for people with personalities and dancing in Billy's vagina. He was looking for this? For some golden triangle? Yeah, for some hairy clams? Yep. For some curly caverns?
You're making me think of 40-year-old virgin. Not the dirty Sanchez.
Okay, curly cavern. TM, TM, TM.
Yeah, don't take... Yeah, trademark that shit right away.
That's mine. 5, 6, 7, 8. The last bit of the movie is the selected few are officially performing their routine on stage, and it's a lot of gold.
What are all the losers who got cut doing there?
Well, I'll tell you. Zach had the chosen few. He said, I wish I could cast you all. So after a while, he's like, you know, I really wish I could have all those people back. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to cast all of these people, this chosen eight, the hateful eight, the grateful eight, the, you know, awesome eight in the main roles. And then these other people who need a bone thrown to them, they can be like background. They can be chorus of the chorus. Because you needed a lot of people. So they all, the rejected dancers showed up. And then there's a whole bunch of other dancers. I'm not going to lie, it did confuse me a little bit.
It made me think of Michael Scott from the dinner party. Like, snip, snap, snip, snap. Yeah. Like, don't play with our emotions like that. Are they in or are they out?
In. They're there. They got the costumes. They got the gold hats. They got the golden mate, you know, what have you. And then they kickstep their way into the credits. Guess what?
Whoa.
It's over. Movie's over.
It's done. Yes. It's over now.
I cannot fucking believe I got a button push on...
Terrence Mann!
Curry!
Not Tim Curry. Oh! I thought for sure it was going to be Richie. I thought for sure it was going to be Richie.
I knew it was going to be...
I should have focused more about Richie in my notes.
I had so much around every scene that Richie was in about not saying good things about him.
That's your problem, bitch.
Fuck. It's just I love Tim Curry so much.
But this isn't Tim Curry. This is not Tim Curry. This is Terrence Mann. Terrence Mann!
For those at home.
Uh-huh.
I do know that allegedly this is Terrence Mann.
No, she doesn't.
It is a true thing that every time I watch this movie and I see him, I do think of Tim Curry, who I love.
Can I tell you now that this is over?
Oh, does Tim Curry love this movie?
I don't know. Probably. I hope so. I also think, because he really does look like Tim Curry.
He does a lot.
He definitely gives a Tim Curry vibe, for sure. He's got Tim Curry realness. For sure.
I can tell you when I started watching this, taking my notes, and I'm like, why isn't he red? It's so stupid.
This is fucking hilarious.
I'm such
a... Oh, I loved it. I really was. I'm not kidding. Like, I'll probably go back and watch at least the audition part.
I 1,000,000% agree with the... What you said about Fosse's, the daughter.
Yeah.
You can tell if you're watching, she's a really good dancer.
Yeah.
Because there are parts, you can see every once in a while, she looks really good. And you can tell she's...
She's definitely holding. So good for her.
Yeah.
I don't think she actually talks like that either. But that's Bob Fosse and Gwen.
Yeah.
I didn't watch it. I mean,
I know. With Sam Rockwell.
Right.
So, and Michelle Williams, really yes. good.
Well, that's their daughter.
Yeah. Yeah,
and really I mean, they're only, yeah, it's his only daughter.
Mm-hmm.
I'll say that the one that plays BB, the one in the green.
The green, yeah.
Still fucking gorgeous.
And a ridiculous dancer.
Oh my God. Oh my God. I loved the part. When I was a kid, when I was an adult, when I watched this 5 seconds ago.
When we're like, Lady in Green, come forward. Yes. Like, yes.
He's like, this is how it's supposed to be done.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, especially when you learn towards the end of the movie, like, you know, I didn't cover it because it's a bit of a downer, but she's like, she was hospitalized because of probably anxiety, maybe depression.
Mm-hmm.
But she struggled a bit. So she came back and this was her first performance since, you know, being hospitalized. And she made it.
Yeah.
As a therapist, just curiosity, how would you handle it? Because it sounds like her therapist was like, this is too early for you. Because she would still probably deal with rejection after this, yeah. even with that.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a tough one. I mean, I think hopefully the person would still be in therapy.
Yeah, yeah.
And you would be really working them through. Like, if this doesn't work out for you, that's not a reflection on your worth or anything like that. There's a million people auditioning. You're getting ready to laugh. Oh, no.
No.
Oh, okay. Yeah, like... That, you know, there it just depends on what somebody likes in that moment. And there could be, you could audition for 5 other people and they would all think that you're amazing. And you just might come in front of the one person that's looking for something different and you're still amazing. I mean, I think you just have to really help them and have that internal self-talk. Like, yeah, that's what I would do.
You're a really fucking good therapist.
Oh, thanks. I love being a therapist.
Gee whiz.
Yeah.
I was super convinced. I thought I was BB in that moment.
Honest, Serene?
Yes.
This is a happy time of year for you. What time of year is this?
Oh, we're about to go into the playoffs. And hockey.
Yes. We're going to do a movie that we have literally gone back and forth dozens of times.
Easily.
Should we do it? Should we not?
For a number of, not because, just because it's good, but a lot of people probably haven't seen it, right. Unfortunately.
But that doesn't, obviously, we don't give a shit about that. We did Care Bears. The reason that we were questioning it is because it was an 80s movie. 70s?
70s.
70s movie. So there are some real problematic things in it. And we're going to do it anyway.
I love it. Guys, I love it. It's going to be, I'm just telling you right now. It's going to be a lot of foxtrots.
Yeah.
And a lot of retireds.
Yeah. Sorry, LGBT community and the community with disabilities. We haven't said what the movie is. Here's the thing. We love Paul Newman. I love a salad dressing. Anna loves hockey. We're doing Slapshot.
I'm so excited.
So get ready, everybody.
Can I ask if I'd love to hear about people's favorite musicals.
Oh, please, because we love doing musicals, but we're not sure if people want to hear about them, so...
Yes, please. Yeah. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, just not Tommy, because fuck off.
I like Tommy, but yeah, I get it. Mm-hmm. I get it for sure.
Yeah.
I haven't said this in a while, but you can get a hold of us super easily. We are at Split Happens Pod on all of the socials, and splithappenspod.com is our website that I kind of update on occasion. Katrina, this was amazing.
This was fun.
I can't wait till next time. Goodbye, Katrina Porter.
Bye, Honest Serene.
Goodbye, everybody.
Bye, everybody.